Well, good evening. Thank you for joining us for the March 16th WIPP Town Hall, being broadcast over live stream by Red Rocket and co-hosted by the City of Carlsbad and the Carlsbad Department of Development. Today, representing the New Mexico Environment Department, we have Will Teeter and WIPP Oversight Staff Manager Jennifer Hart in the back. We always appreciate representatives of our congressional delegation, including Beverly Allen with Senator Udall's office, Diane Ventura with Senator Heinrich's office, and Bernadette Granger with Congressman Pierce's office. We also have City Councilman and Mayor Pro Tem Dick Doss, and also Councilman Eddie Rodriguez. There have been major developments since we last held the town hall. As I think everyone here knows, WIPP began in placement in January, and then Secretary Ernest Moniz joined us. Congratulations once again to the Department of Energy and its contractors for getting WIPP back open for business. You should be very proud of your accomplishments, bringing a facility back to operations after a shutdown is in many ways every bit as difficult as opening a new one. Congratulations. We now look forward to working closely with confirmed Energy Secretary Rick Perry. We believe Secretary Perry would benefit greatly from visiting WIPP in person, and we very much hope he is able to do so this fall. The residents of Carlsbad know WIPP is the jewel of the Department of Energy, and we look forward to working closely with the DOE and its contractors. Our speakers tonight will be Todd Schrader, Andy Walker, and Tammy Reynolds. As all of you know, John Heaton is the chair of the Carlsbad Mayor's Nuclear Task Force, and he'll be the moderator for the evening. So, John?
Better late than never, huh?
Thank you very much. Same rules will prevail as have in the past. We'll hear from our speakers, and we'll entertain questions here, first of all, and then we'll go online. So with that brief introduction, thank you all for being here. And Todd, you're going to begin. Thank you.
Thank you, John. I think we're actually going to be a little bit briefer tonight with some of our updates here, but I'll start off with a general update on the site, and particularly in talk about shipping issues and where we are with that. Andy's going to go into a little bit more detail on the process of shipping and what's going to happen about with that process. You know, we certainly have not shipped in 3 years, so just to remind everyone there. And then Tammy, I'll talk about what's happening at the site itself specifically. And I apologize, we have to hold the mic tonight. We don't have a stand for it, so. Before we start, I do want to introduce one guest from headquarters here. He's probably embarrassed I'm going to introduce him, but Jason, if you could stand up. He has recently joined EM. Why don't you tell him your position, because I don't remember exactly what it is. So.
I will be at risk in trying to repeat the titles there. They're all very long. I'm Jason Donaldson. I'm the Deputy for Corporate Services in Environmental Management. So we support the budget, acquisitions, and human resources for EMY, work closely with folks throughout EM. So
thanks, Jason. And if we don't get the budget we need, it's Jason's fault. So, but no, he's glad he had a chance to come out. We do work very closely with headquarters. You know, one of the things that you may have seen recently is this one EM philosophy that headquarters has talked about, and more of a field-centric philosophy of supporting the field and moving, focusing the efforts on supporting the field. And Jason being here, I think, only reinforces that message that Sue Cange and others have been making up at headquarters. The other thing, of course, I want to talk about is what happened recently. As everyone knows, the site reopened on January 4th was our actual first emplacement. We technically reopened December 23rd is when we signed the authorizations, but for various reasons, January 4th was the first time for first emplacement. Since that time, we've emplaced right around 200 of the containers that were in the waste handling building. We got about 40 or so left, and we expect that in the next few weeks, a relatively short time frame, we should get the rest of the emplacements done. We'll talk about some of the challenges of that. As Mayor Janeway mentioned, we do have a new secretary. He was confirmed a couple weeks ago, Secretary Perry, so that was good news. And the rest of the political team at headquarters is starting to fill out with the deputy secretary, the assistant secretary. I would hope that there will be some announcements on that relatively soon on some of those other positions. And then I'll talk about shipping, like I say, and some of the other issues associated with it. So shipping itself, talk about what we have to do to get to that point for sites to reship. All waste, regardless of when it was certified, when it was packaged, etc., has to meet our new DSA requirements. And we talked a couple months ago, Jeff talked, or a couple sessions ago, Jeff Carswell talked about the process for moving through the documented safety analysis. To remind everyone, that's our safety envelope. All operations have to take place within those analyzed accidents. And you make assumptions about what the waste is going to be, what the composition of the waste is, what is in that to do the accident analysis within the documented safety analysis. And so that's why it's very important that the waste meet the waste acceptance criteria and or the documented safety analysis requirements that are in Chapter 18 of our documented safety analysis. And it's why we go to so much trouble right now doing chemical compatibility evaluations, et cetera, of all the waste that's out in the complex. The other thing, key document that we've recently just about finalized the first revision of is the basis of knowledge. As you recall, last year, Lanel Carlsbad did a series of tests here in town on oxidizing chemicals. They chose a huge range of different chemicals, brought them into a test facility, a glove box specifically, and determined how fast they would oxidize, and another way of saying how fast they would burn. This gave us the data we needed to determine what chemicals we have to worry about in the chemical in the waste streams, and which chemicals that we don't have to worry about, because although they might be oxidizers, they simply cannot, they're not energetic enough to cause us an issue in the future. Interesting enough, the other side of that is some oxidizers are highly oxidizing, and the fact is they probably aren't in the waste because they oxidized away a long time ago, they chemically reacted. A good example of this is hydrogen peroxide. I think everyone's familiar when you put it on your cut, your finger, whatever. I mean, it oxidizes in air. It simply consumes itself in a very rapid time frame. And so all of that information is what we're working on now to determine the acceptability of the various waste streams that are out there. It turns out quite a few waste streams have oxidizers in them. That does not mean that they need a RCRA code D001 for oxidizing waste. It just means that the chemicals are potentially there, and we have to analyze it and go through and look at the waste a little bit more carefully. The true generator sites themselves will go through their certification programs. This is the standard certification, annual certification audits that we performed for many years in this program. We're in the process of doing that for all of the sites moving forward. All the previous waste must be reviewed to verify that it meets, and I have a typo there, it's not the new WAC, it's the new DSA requirements. For previously certified waste, newly certified waste has to meet the new waste acceptance criteria. I apologize for that typo there. And again, that we talked about that in the past also. And then finally, the sites themselves are going through some readiness activities themselves, similar to the ORR we did, to verify they're ready to load the waste into the true packs and do the work they have to do at their sites to get the waste ready to move. As you remember, about a month ago, we put out a WIPP update, for those of you who saw it, to look at our projected shipping rates. When we put this together, we started looking at all the factors that affect shipping, and you can see a bullet there. One of the most important is how fast we can actually emplace the waste. And right now, we're averaging about 2 emplacements a week, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second here. Frankly, waste that's available to ship from the various sites, regulatory commitments and agreements, where we are in our transportation capabilities and obviously some flexibility with changing requirements. So we put all of that together and we came up with a schedule or projected shipment rate there, and you can see it at the bottom. I will say this, between now and January 2018, we will do a number of shipments. Do I think it'll be exactly 128? No, that's just a projection looking at it. Do I think it'll be in that area? Yes, I do. Generally speaking, Idaho will be about half the shipments. We anticipate that. The other sites, you can see the rough rates we're looking at. I will say we've already, even since we put this together, waste control specialists, this is the facility over in Andrews, Texas. Although we had originally looked at 11 shipments for sort of an initial shipment, we actually think that number is probably about double when it's all said and done by January of 2018. We think we're going to get more than that in there moving forward. So timing and origin, again, we talked about right now we're in placing two shipments a week, roughly the equivalent of that, and so that translates into obviously two trucks coming in. One of the things we're not going to happen or let happen is we're not going to let waste back up in the waste handling building. So we're going to try for the most part to keep up with a general philosophy of just-in-time receipt. So it arrives, gets unloaded, it gets in placed, move forward. So our actual limiting factor for shipping is not the shipping resources or the shipping capabilities, it's our emplacement capabilities is what drives our actual shipping rate in the long run. Again, right now we're at two a week. We hope to ramp that up to about 4 a week by the end of the year. And I got a chart and I'll explain a little bit more about that in a minute. Again, 128 shipments, approximate number between now and the beginning of next year. The first group will be waste control specialist, Idaho and Savannah River. Not necessarily in that order. We're still finalizing when that'll happen. Those shipments, we will start shipping in April. That we're very confident in. Just the exact site, we're still working through the last little details on exactly who would go in what order. Some of the other factors that affect how we decide what sites ship is our effect in the underground itself. It turns out that some of the waste streams, for instance, from Idaho, which are in some cases old Rocky Flats waste streams, have a lot of volatile organic compounds in them. This was from the old processing systems and solvents that were used at Rocky Flats and other places. You know, for our workers in the underground and for industrial health reasons, you don't want to get all of that waste all next to each other. You get a very high source of VOCs in the underground. So we like spreading out that waste a little bit if we can and mixing in with other waste. A similar issue, you know, some of the pipe overpack containers, the downblended plutonium that we've received in the past from Rocky Flats or potentially, you know, some of the plutonium oxide from Savannah River in the future, has higher curie limits. And so you don't want to put that all together. You actually want to mix all the waste into a nice heterogeneous mixture, and it actually lowers your accident evaluations or your consequences out of your accident evaluations. And then maximize real estate. We talked about before that we're in panel 7, and Tammy will talk a little bit more about this, but we're not using all of panel 7. Panel rooms 4, room 6, and most of room 7 have already been lost. And real estate is very important in the underground, so we want to maximize the efficiency of the packing in the underground, and that's between standard waste boxes, 10 drum overpacks, and various drum configurations. So I mentioned a couple times about emplacement rates. This gives you a sense on where we think we are. The scale, hopefully everyone can read that on the left. We're starting off at about two shipments a week, or two emplacements a week, and or two shipments a week. Thank you, now that we can move around with the microphone. This area here, this two emplacements or two shipments per week is where we are right now. We anticipate through some efficiency gains and just getting better at the work, we should get up to three sometime later this year, and going into next year, 2018, we're hoping to get to four emplacements a week. After that, We're going to need some more process improvements. We're looking at different things. We hope to raise that maybe to, you know, 4, 5, or 6 to 8 at some point in the future. We'll see. You know, to be honest, we're still looking through that to find out where we were. As you remember, our WIPP itself used to do, I don't know, 25, 30 shipments a week. In the past, that was well above the standard rate. The design capacity of the facility is 17 emplacements a week. And so that's what we're trying to get back to here. As you can see, though, we don't anticipate getting to that point until around FY 21 or 22. And the reason is twofold. One, panel 7 is contaminated, and it just takes a long time to do an emplacement in a contaminated area because you have to move the waste from the clean area, you have to transition through, you have to get everyone suited up. They have to go in, you know, PAPRs, anesthesia, et cetera. It's difficult work for our workers. And right now it's taking, I don't know, about 6 hours to an emplacement. At one time we were hoping more like 4 hours. We're not there yet. We're going to constantly have to look at that. The other thing that's going to drive, and so consequently, consequently, until you get out of panel 7, which is contaminated, you're going to be limited by that. We hope, you know, obviously after panel 7 is to get in panel 8. Panel 8's clean area, much easier for our workers to go in. They can go in essentially in their work clothes. We are going to start mining in panel 8 here later this year and have it ready when panel 7 is done. That's a real key point. We show here sort of a window of when panel 8 is going to be complete. That's driven by many things, such as how many miners we have, you know, our funding levels. It's driven by how fast we actually mine, et cetera. But it's most importantly driven by air. As you remember, we can't mine and emplace at the same time. We simply don't have enough air, so we have to do them in some kind of sequential operations. And we've talked about different things, maybe a week of mining, week of emplacement, or front shift, back shift, and we're still working through those. The key is when PVS comes online, and we've talked about that system. That'll give us over 500,000 cubic feet of air in the underground, and at that point, we can do both mine and emplace simultaneously. So we anticipate significant increases in how fast we're getting panel 8 ready at this point. So lots of moving pieces there. The key is try to be ready as soon as panel 7's done to move on to panel 8 and ramp up when it's safe to do so and when we can efficiently do so. The last thing I'll point out is we talk a lot about waste emplacement on a per week basis, 2 a week, 3 a week, 4 a week. The other piece that drives our overall disposal is how many weeks a year you dispose of waste. Nominally, it's 42 weeks a year is what our sort of planning basis is. I guess in the past, Casey, we were up to 48, 50, maybe in our 48 in very good years. We don't anticipate that in the short term. And in fact, we have a major maintenance activity coming up in a couple years for the waste hoist upgrade. This is a multi-month, 6, 8, 9 month operation. I don't think we've completely decided if it's going to be all in one span or we'll split it up over you know, 2 or 3 different outages. We're still working that. But that means that the number of shipping weeks per year will fall considerably during those years. So total emplacement, even though we may ramp up on a per week basis, total emplacement may actually go down a little bit in those out years. And that's because, you know, it's a 30-year-old waste hoist and we need to do significant upgrades to it. Moving forward with the facility. So hopefully that gives you a sense on what our thinking is on waste emplacement, shipping rates, et cetera, as we move forward. So with that, I will turn it over to Andy to talk a little bit more about the shipping logistics and everything involved with that.
All right, thank you. Make sure I know how to run this thing. Is it more narrow?
Okay. Thank you. Right. Transportation guy.
Yeah. There's no buttons on transportation, though. All right. Thank you, guys, for giving me an opportunity to come and talk about what I know I've been anxious, and I'm sure everybody's been anxious to talk about transportation. It's been 3 long years since we had an active waste shipment on the road, and we're getting closer to resuming that. So that's a very good thing in our opinion. I got to push the button. Okay. I just wanted to touch base. You know, when we do resume shipments, we're going to use this, utilize the same transportation processes that we have used the years that we've been making shipments. And those protocols that we've agreed with the stakeholders along the routes have proven to be very effective in a safe transportation system. So we'll use those same protocols that have proven to be safe. A few of the things I'll touch on is the transportation contracts, which is our carrier contracts that actually transport the waste. I'll touch on the mobile loading unit personnel, which is the folks that actually build the payloads and put them into the shipping casks at the generator sites. I'll touch on the WIPP routes, which is our transportation corridors. And then I'll touch on the CVSA Level 6 inspection program, which is Commercial Vehicle Safety Alliance program. And then we'll talk about the working with affected states and tribes along the corridors and the notifications that we give to those groups before shipments. Okay, for the transportation contracts, currently we have two transportation contractors. We've got CAS Specialty Transportation and Visionary Solutions, which have operated since 2014. They've both operated with reduced services because of the events. We reduced their services down and we kept the capability to transport if emergent shipments came up, or we still had to support road shows across the country to support things like CVSA Level 6 training, public awareness events to that. So we kept enough driver teams and tractors to support those things and respond if we did have inter-site shipments or shipments that we needed to move. The coming soon, we'll be transitioning to a new carrier contract. It'll just be a single carrier rather than two. Just looking at the shipping rates for, and these are 5-year contracts, so looking at the shipping rates through the early part of that 5 years, we just couldn't justify having two separate carriers. So we thought one carrier would best fit our needs, so we'll have a single carrier contract. We're expecting to begin the transition into that new contract in May, and it should be complete and transitioned into that new contract by the end of July of this year. So that's coming soon. One-handed operating here. Okay, as far as the mobile loading of the troop packs, like I say, that we call them MLU teams. We've got the equivalent of three teams. We call it equivalent of because it's basically five personnel that consist of a team. Some sites like Idaho that provide us more support at the generator site, we can get by with a few less people. But sites that we're doing outdoor loading, like Oak Ridge, we might have to have a couple of additional folks. So we don't really call it exact teams, but we call it equivalent teams. And those teams do work across the complex. They load the waste, build the payloads, and load the waste at every generator site that we ship from. The teams have been performing continued proficiency evolutions ever since the events of 2014. We didn't want those, it takes a long time to train one of those personnel to do that function. So we didn't want their qualifications or expertise waning. So we have continued to do evolutions to keep them sharp. So every one of our sites either have had or will have a management self-assessment or an independent readiness assessment, which the generator site can do of our folks before we actually ship true waste from that generator site. We've recently completed readiness assessments at Savannah River and WCS in Texas. The WCS one, we actually had our CBFO QA office over to do a surveillance of that loading evolution. So everything turned out good on that, so we're prepared at those two sites to load and ship. Idaho, we've continually done evolutions there, so we're prepared at Idaho. Oak Ridge and Lanel, we've got within the next couple of months, we'll do proficiency evolutions with a readiness assessment at those sites as well. Next slide's about our routes, and this is just an overall view of the national routes that we use to come into the WIPP site from the generator sites. We have made over 11,800 shipments to WIPP on these routes, and those have been safe shipments, and that covers over 14 million miles of loaded shipment miles. We additionally have made 172 intersite shipments. That would be from one generator site to the other. It may be for coring, it may be for sending it to Idaho for compaction or characterization, but 172 of those. The inner box, the, let me get the pointer here. Gotta use the pointer if you're up here. So the inner box is the actual closer to Carlsbad routes. Our permanent route from the south, which would cover Savannah River, Oak Ridge, is the I-20, comes all the way across. And at Pecos, we take 285 up and come through Carlsbad and go out the Hobbs Highway into the North Access Road. For the WCS shipments, New Mexico, this was an alternate temporary route that New Mexico had granted to us. So they have given us authorization to use this alternate temporary route, which would go from WCS on 176, just right before you get to Eunice, you take New Mexico 18 down to Jal, and then the Jal Highway to the South Access Road. So they have given us authorization to use that route just for the WCS shipments. But the future Savannah River and Oak Ridge shipments will use the I-20 route into New Mexico. Okay, oops, one more, there we go. For the level six, like I say, CVSA is Commercial Vehicle Safety Alliance. We do have a cooperative agreement with CVSA where we provide funding for that organization to train state inspectors on all of the WIPP route states. So we help in funding that training. And it's a very good program. It's a safe program. Level six program applies to highway route control quantities of radioactive material. But WIPP, with our WIPP shipments, a percentage of our shipments would actually meet the threshold of HRCQ. But in our agreements with the states, we treat all WIPP shipments as if they are HRCQ. They're a highway route control quantity. Thank you. I'm good at using acronyms and not good at... So it is a very safe program. The HRC or the CVSA level six is the highest criteria of inspection CVSA does. It involves the tractor, the trailer, all the maintenance of it, the driver, his logbooks, medical records, and then the as you can see in the picture, the inspectors actually use survey meters and take surveys of the package. Okay, let's see. Per our agreements with the state regional groups, like say all TruWay shipments require that level six inspection. And the officers from the state inspection enforcement agencies along the routes have been conducting refresher training, like I say, which is we assist with the funding for. Those are a couple of pictures of, I'm not sure which state that is, but that's a couple of pictures of actual state inspectors performing a level six inspection. Okay, for preparing the shipping corridors, since it's been 3 years since we've had waste shipments, now we've done a lot of road shows, but getting ready for moving waste again, we've been communicating with our state regional groups and tribal representatives to ensure that the corridors are prepared for shipments to resume. The outreach activities that we've been doing include pre-shipment communications with folks like WGA, Western Governors Association, I caught it that time, and then the Southern States Energy Board and the Council of State Governments Midwest region. So we work with all those folks, and we have been doing road shows as well. Road show is basically where we send one of our transports out with packages and we'll stop and do public awareness presentations. And we'll have we've had good participation. Recently, we completed one in Carlsbad. We had it here in Carlsbad over by the Jenkins Furniture parking lot. That was on February the 1st. And then we went over to Hobbs on February 2nd, had a road show over there. We had good participation at both of those. We had also a complete route road shows that we have planned. The one from the south that departed from the Savannah River area in South Carolina, and it actually left this last Monday. It's en route now. I think they're in Fort Worth today, so that'll be the stop in Texas, and then they'll come on in, probably complete tomorrow. We've got one planned for the, we've got one planned for the north route, which will depart out of the Idaho area up by Idaho National Lab, and that one will leave the 27th of March. So that's for the road shows. The pre-shipment dry runs, we call, for each corridor. That was, it's empty packages, but we ran it along the transportation route as if it were a loaded shipment. So all of our shipments are monitored by Transcom, which is a satellite tracking system. And stakeholders along the route have the ability to view the shipment as it's going across the states. So we turned it on, in Transcom so that they could watch it. I've got one, just getting over his head cold, so my throat's itchy. But we turned it on Transcom so that they could view the shipments, and we gave them the opportunity to do what we call over-the-road exercises. They could simulate a tractor breaking down, being out of service, or simulate that Transcom stopped working. So we've completed those. We did the south route February 27th, and we did the north route March the 6th. So those have been completed. Let's see. Next. Okay, notification to state and tribal regulators. In accordance with our WIPP program implementation guide, which we affectionately call the PIG, which is a Western Governors Association coordinated document, we worked with WGA to develop that program implementation guide. Governor designees and state commercial vehicle enforcement and emergency management personnel in the host states and along the shipping corridors are provided a series of advance notifications before shipments go through. These are necessary to ensure the readiness of the routes prior to shipments through the states and tribes. We also put out a semi-annual notification letter in the slide that Todd showed that had the 128. That's basically came off of that semi-annual notification. We also do 14-day advance notifications, and that's provided to governors and governor designees prior to the use of the shipping route, and that is included for the first five shipments along that route. And our official notification to the stakeholders is what we call the 8-week rolling schedule. And it's provided on a weekly basis. It's a rolling 8-week window. That 8-week is considered a security sensitive document and is provided to stakeholders on a need to know basis. And I think that's all for me, Tammy.
Thank you, Andy, and good evening, everybody. So what I'd like to do tonight is finish up. Our last item on the agenda is to talk about plant status and sustainability. So I'm going to cover several different topics. You can see those topics right here. I'm going to talk about waste emplacement, status of panel 7, talk about some ground control, ventilation, and ultimately keys to sustainment. So waste emplacement progress, as Todd indicated, on January the 4th, we did begin waste emplacement with the waste in the waste handling building. We have to date emplaced approximately 200 waste containers from those emplacements. We've got 11 pallets of waste left in the waste handling building to emplace. And as soon as we get the basis of knowledge document and then go through filling out the criteria associated with that document, then some of that waste will continue to go into the underground. As indicated, we started very slowly with oversight watching our evolutions, because it is different than what the waste handlers were familiar with doing prior to the events. And so we had what we call senior supervisory watches. Some of our senior management team watched the evolutions and made sure that, you know, we were working everything according to our process and procedures. So we started with a single pallet per shift on Tuesdays and Thursdays, because we have to balance the waste emplacement with continued ground control activities in the underground. And we've worked our way up now to two pallets per shift on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And that's been through continuous improvement from pre-jobs and post-job evolution. So after the waste emplacement activities, we would go back through the procedures and the waste handlers would talk about, okay, if we did this or this instead in different orders, then we could improve our efficiency factors. And so we have been able to work our way up to currently two pallets per shift. So that would be a total of four pallets on a week's basis. And we're going to continue to look for efficiencies as we progress through working in, you know, radiological contaminated area. Okay, the next topic, panel 7 status, which is where we are in placing the waste. So let me just kind of show you what's going on. On the slide right here, that is where the waste is going into the underground. So what you see there is this white area there, that is room 7, which we all know has been closed now with bulkheads. So we started just to the other side of the bulkhead on the entrance side of room 7, and that's where the waste containers are going. And the way we'll progress, so I can get out the way here, we'll put waste up into this area, and then we'll start here, and then go through here, there, there, and then to room 1. So that's the sequence of how we'll continue in placing waste in panel 7. Right now in panel 7, we're continuing to do catch-up bolting, because that was one of the areas that, due to the suspension of ground control activities from the time the events occurred until about 9 months later, this was one of the areas that our geotechnical engineers and our ground monitoring program had shown movement. And so we're currently, we've been working for the most part two bolters on a day shift and on a back shift until recently, where we've pretty much gotten caught up and we're just finishing some bolting activities. So right now we're running one bolter in panel 7. But the schedule currently is that by June, the end of June of this year, we will have finished ground control activities, those catch-up activities in panel 7. And that's a combination of putting in bolts, because what we do in that panel is we put in a series, what we call a 7-bolt pattern. So across the width of the room, you put in 7 bolts spread evenly across. You go down 5 feet, put in another 7 bolts across. And so by the end of June, we'll have the 7-bolt pattern in all of these areas that you see here. Plus, there has been some ground movement, so there's been some floor heaves in certain areas of panel 7, and we have to go in and mill out those areas and then level that floor back down, because we have to make sure that when we get ready to emplace waste in those areas, we want the forklift that runs over that with the waste pallets to be very level, so that we're not, you know, causing any perturbation in them moving across the floor area. Now, the two areas in red, room 4 and room 6, the red means they're prohibited. So in room 6, we are not doing any ground control activities in there. That is where some equipment had been stored and moved into that area after the events for ultimate disposal. And so those areas are not being maintained. In room 4, that was where we had the ground fall that was predicted by our geotechnical program. And so we do not plan to recover room 4 as well. And so going back to the model that Todd showed you earlier, so now what we have to do, we have to model based on our emplacement rate, which goes back to the number of shipments a week. and then getting panel 8 ready. That's the two drivers there, is to, you know, as we build panel 7, work towards having panel 8 ready to start receiving waste. Now, on the topic of ground control, as I mentioned, we are still catching up on ground control from the events. We will finish catch-up, what we call catch-up bolting, in January 2018. So from this map, there's been a significant amount of progress in this area. So all of that green area that you see on the map there, that's all been caught up, and that includes the bolting in the back and also any floor issues that we had to deal with. The areas in red are those areas right now that are prohibited. See it right there, along there, and then the south end, and then panel 8. So the red areas is what is left to have catch-up bolting performed. And those areas right now are prohibited, which means we're not doing any ground control activities in there. We do have a schedule. We have prioritized what comes first based on our current geotechnical monitoring data. And so as we finish in panel 7, then we'll start moving into the next areas, into East 300, into panel 8, which is actually starting this week. They've started going in now. We have to bolt our way in. We've got some equipment in panel 8 to get ready for mining that needs to be moved out of panel 8 because it happened to be in that panel when the events occurred. So we need to bolt our way in, get access to that equipment, get that equipment so we can operate it and move it out of panel 8, and then we can go in and basically do catch-up bolting in the areas that was already mined, and then go ahead and continue, finish mining in panel 8 so it can be ready for waste emplacement after panel 7. Talking about right here? Yeah, that should. I think that's orange. That's that dark orange. It's kind of misleading, Norbert, with the light on it. Yeah. Yeah. So what it's supposed to be showing you, and I agree, the color is a little bit misleading. That's where we're continuing to finish up catch-up bolting. Yeah. Good question. So as I indicated, we should be caught up with the ground control in January 2018. Okay, so next I'll move into the far south enclosure. So as you're aware, part of the catch-up bolting, that entire scope, with our ventilation challenges right now, the minimum ventilation that we have, we made a decision this past year to go ahead and close panel the far south, what we call the south end. So there's no other ground control activities taking place in that area, which is shown by this red box. What we're getting ready to do, and we already have the cribbing at the site, we're getting ready to go in and put up temporary closures, which is a combination of cribbing, and so it's basically going to be interlocking pieces of wood that's going to interlock and close off those drifts going down to that south end. And in addition to that, ventilation curtains, and we are going to also install some geotechnical instrumentation so we can monitor the ground movement right at those closures. But the purpose of this cribbing is to make sure that since we are not doing any more ground control on the far side, the south side of where the cribbing's going to go, we want to monitor that, but that cribbing will also make sure that if we do have a ground control, like a fall from the back, that it doesn't progress to the north side of where we're going to install the cribbing. So we're working on that. We're getting ready to start putting that cribbing in. We've got to bolt our way into some of those areas, not far, just, 20 or 30 feet type on bolting. So we're working on the bolting, install the cribbing. And then we're also working with the regulators because that's considered temporary closing of those, the south end. We have to work with the regulators to do the final closure of that south end and what that needs to look like. You know, it may be something like 100 foot of run-of-mine salt, and so we'll work with the regulators and come up with what the final closure will look like. But the temporary closure will satisfy the needs right now so that we can move away and then also redirect the ventilation from that area into the areas where we occupy and we'll be emplacing waste. Okay, the other thing, so talking about now ventilation, the supplemental ventilation, as you know from the recovery, we had three phases of ventilation. Right now we're in filtered ventilation mode. We installed the interim ventilation system as part of recovery so that we had more redundancy with our filter banks and also some increased airflow because we needed increased airflow in the underground for waste emplacement as well as to be able to do more activities in parallel. So the next step now is to get back into mining. And I talked about the importance and where we're watching, you know, the panel 7 filling rate and where we're watching when we need to have panel 8 ready. We need supplemental ventilation to do that because we need to be on unfiltered ventilation due to the amount of salt dust that the mining activity itself is going to generate. And so we're going to divide the underground into two different ventilation circuits. The current ventilation circuit, which has the contamination associated with it, will continue as it is. But then the area near panel 8 that we need to do mining, that'll be a separate ventilation circuit with this fan that you see in the picture, which will draw air in to the underground and then back out of the salt shaft. And that would be the air that comes from the mining activities. So there would be an expectation that there will be some salt dust in that air. And trying to put that dust, that salt dust, through filter banks, it would be non-productive. We would be changing filters all the time versus being able to do mining. So this fan, plus we're going to also install what we call de-dusters. These are going to be units that where the mining equipment is actually doing the mining. It will draw that air into the de-duster, which has a local filter right there. And so we're going to try to minimize as much of that salt dust that goes up the salt shaft with these de-dusters. We've got to put those in. We've got to see how efficient those are and make sure that they're really going to, you know, do what we need them to do. And they also can do it in a manner that's going to allow us to sustain mining activities in a productive manner. So that fan is going in. The fan's already in. We're hooking up the controls for it right now because we have to put interlocks in place, and these are safety significant controls. We have to make sure that we always have a more positive pressure on this side of the ventilation circuit versus the contaminated side, because you don't want the contaminated air to come back into the clean side where it would be unfiltered exhaust to the atmosphere. So those interlocking features are being installed now, and this system will be online at the end of September is what it's currently scheduled to be ready. And at that point, in parallel, we're also getting mining equipment ready, and as you saw, getting ready to do ground control in panel 8 so that when this fan ventilation system is installed at the end of the fiscal year, we're ready in a position to start mining again. Okay, next topic is the new ventilation shaft. So if you might have been out to the site recently, you may have seen an apparatus, a drilling type apparatus across from the parking lot at WIPP. What that was about is this is the core drilling. It's a 4-inch diameter core drill that went down the length of what the shaft will ultimately go to look at the geology in preparation for drilling the actual shaft. And so it was a top-down drilling method. It went down 2,300 feet. That has now been completed. And then construction on this project will begin around March 2018. And expected to be finished December of 2020. So that project is moving along well. It's in the final design stages as we speak. And then along with that project is the permanent ventilation, the new filter building. So that is also in the final stages of design. And this is the building that will take the air and pull that air through the underground, just similar to what we have today. It'll have the capability for filtered air as well as unfiltered air. This will get us back to roughly about 540,000 CFM. And again, this project, which is part, coincides with the shaft project, is going to start construction in March of 2018 and also scheduled to finish around December of 2020. So the next couple of slides, this is a conceptual depiction of the new footprint. So in this picture, here is the new shaft right here, and then the drifts that go out to the new shaft. And so you can see that everything's moving towards the west. So right across the parking lot, the current parking lot at the WIPP site. And, you know, we'll give priority to disposal areas that the shaft versus also in alignment with new panels that would be in that same area towards the west will give us the ability to compensate for some of the lost ground that we've lost, you know, the south end, some of the space in panel 7. And so actual design of that and all are under review right now. And we would do that mining just like we're going to mine panel 8, our traditional methods of the mining equipment, just like we've done in the past for the panels that exist today. So some of the things that have to be considered, some of the actions related to the new footprint. Number one, we have to get approval for the design. We have to work with our regulators to get agreement on that design and the footprint, as well as the Land Withdrawal Act. That's another consideration to make sure we stay in compliance with that. And the priority would be to have this new footprint and those actions that I just mentioned there in place and ready to receive waste prior to completing panel 8, which is expected to be finished the end of FY25, fourth quarter of FY25. So that's kind of where we're headed in the future. And then the last thing I wanted to talk about is keys to sustainment. So just as important as recovery is to sustain where we've gotten to now. And that's a combination of safety management programs, improvements there, infrastructure improvements, you know, new equipment, things like that. And so what we consider the keys to sustaining where we're at today for continued success with our mission and the ability to continue to perform that mission is, number one, we have to have a sound safety culture. And when I talk about safety culture, I'm not only talking about industrial safety, we have to be safe, but I'm also talking about that nuclear safety culture that comes with that disciplined approach to operating a nuclear facility, which is what the WIPP facility is. So we have to make sure that we continue to improve through continuous improvement, and that's a combination of lessons learned, procedures improvement, employee suggestions, timeouts, taking timeouts when things aren't going right, and continuing to learn through those. The other key to sustainment is our procedure and technical baseline. We always have to make sure we maintain that. And what that means is we have a DSA that has certain controls associated with that that we have to ensure we maintain on a day-to-day basis. We have implementing procedures. We have to make sure we remain compliant with those implementing procedures when we're performing activities. Succession planning is also very important. You know, we have a very talented workforce and a very talented team. Many of those folks have been there for years. People are going to retire. People will move on to different jobs. People may move from one organization to another. And as we move forward and sustain the level of performance, we have to make sure that as we backfill those positions, that we pick the right people to do that based on their prior experience, based on how they performed. And so those are, you know, important elements that we have to consider when we're replacing some of those positions. Contractor assurance, very important safety management program. This is where we have to always look for how are we doing, and that's through self-assessments, independent assessments. We need to go out and benchmark. We need to use things that other sites have learned, share with them things that we've learned, And then also our issues management process. We need to make sure when we identify issues that we document those issues and that we establish corrective actions to go correct those issues and gaps that we see so that we're continuing to improve again. And then the last one there is adequate funding and balance. I think we've all seen that you can't just accomplish the mission without a balance with maintaining the facility as well. And so we need to make sure as we move forward that as we place waste and we receive shipments, we also balance the funding that's available with maintaining the facility, infrastructure improvements, corrective maintenance, and make sure that there's the right balance there to make sure the facility not only can perform the mission, but does that safely and in the manner that's expected. So those are all things, and not any one of those are less important than the other. They all work together, but they're critical and just as important as recovery to ensure that we sustain where we're at today. Again, just to close, all of these things are vital and they all work together to make sure that we continue to improve.
Okay. Boy, what great presentations. Thank you. I think there's a marvelous update on where we are, and I think if anybody doesn't realize how complicated all of this is, I think they should be fully aware of it right now when you see all of the moving parts that are in the whole mix of things. Jason, thank you for being here. We appreciate people from headquarters being here whenever they can, so you have a real perspective on what's going on. So thank you. And I can tell you, I don't know where Todd Schrader came from, but he's been managing this thing, and it really is a complicated process that's been going on. And I think we're very, very lucky that he showed up on the scene. So,
thanks.
from headquarters. But anyway, you've been around, been around the complex. So we appreciate you very much. And I can tell you, Beverly, thank you, and Diane, and I don't know where Bernadette went, but thank you all for being here. I just got back from Washington, met with Senator Udall, Senator Heinrich, and Congressman Pierce. And they are just undoubtedly major supporters of the project and are critical in terms of funding and understanding what's going on. And I can tell you, when the mayor and Councilman Doss and myself are at meetings around with Energy Communities Alliance and other places, I can't tell you how much they want WIPP to get open and WIPP to get up to full speed and as quickly as possible. I mean, they've been harassing us now for 3 years about when's WIPP going to get open? When's WIPP going to get open? And I think the whole complex feels that way. And I think when we make visits on the Hill, I think we get a sense that Congress really understands how important it is to the cleanup process that's going on in the whole DOE complex. And when we talk about transportation, I don't think Andy mentioned, and I often think about the 14 million miles we've traveled, and I think that calculates to the moon and back about seven times. So how many? 28 times. Well, I'm way off. Maybe I'm going to the sun. But at any rate, that's if you put it in that perspective, I think it really makes you understand how much distance they've traveled. And I think the transportation system is really an untold story about WIPP. It is clearly the most visible part of the whole disposal process and the part of the process that in the beginning we had more concern about than WIPP itself. I mean, it's coming through my community. Is there going to be a problem? On and on and on. And I think what the transportation folks did in getting out and talking to communities and talking to states and making them understand what was going on and these road shows that happened and now reopening corridors are really critical in terms of re-educating people about the whole process and the whole transportation system. So it's a very meaningful process that's going on. And when other transportation systems get talked about in the country, whether it's spent fuel or whatever it is, we always stand up and say, you know, you've got a great model to follow. Here's the only truck that's going around the road that's driving at the speed limit. There's rubber on the tires. The tires are filled to the specifications they're supposed to be filled to. There's no leaking in the hydraulic lines. It's the safest truck going down the road, knock on wood. We want it to stay that way. But at any rate, it really is an incredible story, I think, all unto itself. So I'll quit yakking. But I think understanding what's happened and what went on and now the process of getting to full opening is really a monumental challenge, and I think we've got a great leader at the helm, so we appreciate that. But so with that, are there any questions, Beverly?
Hi, it's Beverly with Senator Tom Udall's office. Andy, I have two questions, if you don't mind. 5 years ago, Senator Udall sent a letter asking for the transportation contract to stay in New Mexico if possible. Carlsbad lost pretty much all the contracts that were here, and that went to a Florida contractor. What I didn't get and I don't know if the other offices did, I don't remember getting the announcement about this one, and I apologize. And just curious who it went to. Is it a New Mexico company by chance?
It has not been awarded yet.
Oh, okay, so that's why we didn't get that. Okay. Is it in process so that maybe we could do that letter encourage a New Mexico company?
The RFP went out several months ago. I'd have to look back and see exactly when the RFP went out. There were some announcements that the RFP was out, but due to the sensitivity of the acquisition process, I can't tell you who put in for it or anything like that.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay, and maybe our DC office can help with that process and find out, because we sure would like to promote that like we did 5 years ago for that company to be a New Mexican company. My other thing is that recently Senator Udall was elected co-chair for the Senate Native American Affairs Committee, also for New Mexico. And so I would encourage you to maybe work with his committee. We actually have some staff now because he has that chairmanship. So we do have our own staff now to work with the Native American communities that are on the route. And I should know this, but I don't. What funding do the local governments, the tribes, what funding do they get to be a responder along the route? Is it DHS? I'd like to find out about that, because some of these things are being cut, and our tribes' access for funding is being cut. So I'd like to work with your office on that aspect and making sure that the governments and everybody gets their gets access to that, because I know even UNIS were struggling.
Yeah, sure. For the tribal members along our routes, for the tribes that we cross with our WIPP routes, we do have a cooperative agreements through the Carlsbad Field Office where we provide them funding to train first responders. And out of our office, James Mason, our institutional affairs officer, is the program manager over those grants. But feel free to contact me. He works for me in my acting role now, and we can communicate with you on that.
So it's Department of Energy funding that pays for the training and stuff?
Okay, yeah, awesome. For WIPP-specific route training, we have cooperative agreements with each route that we cross their tribal lands.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much.
Sure,
I appreciate it.
No problem.
Anybody else have a question? Yes. Councilman, thanks for coming.
Hi, I'm Eddie Rodriguez. Question I've got is, with the new secretary, do we anticipate any kind of paradigm change or a shift? Are we going to have to regroup our funding requests in any way, shape, or form? Or is there going to be a shift of any sort that we should anticipate and maybe counter?
The obviously the new secretary is on board, but as I mentioned, the whole political team isn't filled out yet. However, with some of the information that was shared today with the president's blueprint for his budget, it would certainly indicate that EM cleanup is a high priority within the department, and I would anticipate WIPP to remain a priority for the Office of Environmental Management going forward.
And I would kind of second that from having just come back. The department itself, a lot of the leaders in the department are not yet appointed, so there's there's a vacuum there until that happens, and that, I don't think that's anything that's unusual. I think that sometimes there's those delays in getting all the appointed staff in place, and it just takes a little bit of time. But there's a little bit of unknown about what goes on, other than seeing the budget that came out today. You can see that hopefully it's in good shape. I think there will be a lot of changes in how that money's spent. I'll tell you that. I had some conversations that indicate that there are going to be other priorities in how the money is spent and how it's distributed in the complex. So there'll be some of those kind of things. I think there's a significant interest in the administration getting into more quickly getting the cleanup done. So that's.
Also, Senator Udall is on a committee that has oversight over Department of Energy Chair Rick Perry. We had a press release today inviting Secretary Perry to come to the labs, and we were on a call the other day with you talking about them, that he's been invited recently here. So we're going to be following up with that letter that you sent Mayor, encouraging him to come to WIPP and work with us on that. But Udall has oversight through Appropriations, Department of Defense. So in committee hearings, he can specifically ask Secretary Perry questions specifically about WIPP, its budget. But he already did that also in vetting him through the process and did vote for to confirm Secretary Perry. And then Heinrich is also oversight over Department of Energy. So we have two New Mexico senators that will have oversight that can ask the Secretary specific questions on that. So especially the appropriations, we're in a good spot for that.
Anybody else? Norbert.
Thank you, Don. I have several questions, but let me just start with maybe three points that have to do with transparency. They're very brief. One is we just last week had the Waste Management 2017 conference in Phoenix, where several WIPP papers were presented, or papers by WIPP participants. I would urge you to, as soon as possible, that is within the next week, to post all those papers on the website. There's no copyright associated with those, because these are done by either government employees or government contractors, so there should be no obstacle to sharing everything that was said at Waste Management 17 on behalf of WIPP, to share that with the public immediately. Second point, at the at a previous meeting, and I think it was two or three meetings ago, I requested a cost breakdown on the recovery expense so far, split up in what was recovery allocated to the fire and recovery allocated to the radioactive materials release. And I was actually told, yeah, we're going to give you that. And I haven't heard one peep about it since then. So I would encourage you to follow up on promises you make during the town hall meeting. So far, you have had a very spotty record on that. And the third brief item on my first question is, I brought up informally with your publications and public relations people in the past that you are putting stuff on the web that is gives the impression that you are transparent, but it's actually a fake transparency. To be specific, you are putting on there the cover letters for inspection reports, and that doesn't tell me anything. Okay. Put the real reports, the meat, on the web. Cover letters don't tell me anything. It just tells you you sent a letter to some secretary or to some agency. That's the information content is zero. So I brought it up informally before. There has been no follow-up action, so I'm bringing it up officially right now and put you on notice.
You know, that's one of the things the committee's been asking for a long time as well, is to have those reports published and then corrective actions associated with those reports, and then dates of completion are all important concepts in terms of transparency and public information about progress and where we are. And so, any other questions? Mary.
I have a question about the way you were talking about when you're going to bring the waste in this time, you're going to be particular where you put certain canisters according to volatile chemicals. I was reading something about that before this, you would bring barrels into the facility, but you could only put them in the way that they showed up. You couldn't determine how to move them around, and I always thought that was rather odd. You know, you're in control of the facility. You should be putting it the way you think it's going to be safely in place. So this is really interesting to me, this remark you made about picking and choosing.
Well, and I, to be honest, I couldn't say what we did before, but as much as possible, it is a little bit of balancing. You know, we don't want to leave waste in a waste handling building for months and months to try to get an exact balance. But certainly for our worker protection, we want to, spread the volatile organic compound containing containers out. You want to mix and match those with non-VOC waste, the same with the plutonium or higher material at risk loaded drums. You want to spread those out also. And so I think Tammy's group is constantly looking at this and determining the best way to mix and match. I'll let her even, sure.
Yeah, because I'm curious about why this was never considered before. It just seems odd.
The difference, Mary, no, actually, it's always been considered. The difference is before our throughput rate was a lot higher, and so we were getting shipments from Savannah River, Idaho, Lanel, multiple sites, and so there was enough throughput that mixing was going on. We would never try to put all like Idaho waste together. We would always mix it with different waste streams from Savannah River or others, those that didn't generate as much VOCs as some of the other waste streams. The reason it's a little bit more watchful now is because that throughput rate is not going to be as high, because we don't have the ventilation and stuff, and we can only in place a couple of days a week. So it's just because the throughput, we just have to be a little bit more mindful about.
So you have the opportunity to kind of look at it more.
Yes, yeah, because we're limited into how fast we can receive it and in place it now. So, and because of the amount of waste we're going to receive the shipments each week, if we just took them all from Idaho, then we would be in a situation where we're putting all VOCs together. Before, we were getting multiple sites at the same time coming to WIPP. So it's the same situation we had before. It's just now there's more opportunity for us to put VOC waste together if we don't watch it and combine it with, say, a Savannah River shipment or a shipment from another site. So nothing's really changed other than the throughput rate causes us to have to watch it closer. Does that make sense?
That's not the impression I got from what I read, but okay. I also had another question. I saw kind of a report on how they're cleaning up Idaho, and they have at least like 600 barrels up there of stuff there backlogged.
Much higher than that?
Well, that's what this gentleman said.
I know. The backlog up there, around the complex, it's around 25,000 or so containers spread out the complex. And Idaho is about 20,000 or that, somewhere in that range,
well,
JR.
For coming here, though.
All will come here. 20,000 will eventually come here. They have a backlog of 20,000 containers in that range. I don't remember the exact number.
Okay. Well, I had a question about, I saw some pictures of them, and this gentleman was explaining how, you know, in the picture, there's a bunch of barrels, but there are also people over here that are having to dig through stuff.
That's a retrieval. They are.
Yeah, it's a retrieval of the stuff that they just dumped into the ground at one point up there, I guess.
There's various retrieval activities at Idaho in the old burial grounds that they have there. And they're retrieving, and in some cases, they pack it into new containers.
How are they discerning what's in these things when they're putting it in a barrel when it's all pieces of stuff and all mixed up and deteriorated?
So the various processes that you're required to follow for the WIPP waste acceptance process includes either a visual examination or a non-destructive examination of the drums. You have to do a non-destructive assay to determine the radionuclide content. There's various processes that all waste generators have to follow, whether it's digging up dirt, whether it's unloading a glove box. They have to know what is in that waste, and we have to verify that we understand what's in the waste before the waste is shipped to us.
Even if it's deteriorated?
They would overpack it into a new container, a new drum, either maybe a standard waste box or a drum or something like that. They would pack it in there. But yes, they film. Don't they film all their retrieval activities up there, JR? Yeah. So there's lots of steps along the way that we use and processes to verify what's actually going into the new waste containers.
Just before I get into my real question, you have a brief follow-up on what Mary said. In the early days of WIPP, we were always saying we are not going to do load management, and due to the low shipping rate right now, we are actually doing load management based on VOCs. We're doing load management based on curies, and we're doing actually, fortunately, happily, load management based on avoiding gunnage, apparently, which we didn't do in the past. We put a lot of empty containers in there in the past. But my real question, my real theme is, these meetings are, of course, always fascinating, especially when you continue on for 1 hour, but they're often much more fascinating in what you don't talk about than rather what you talk about. And what you didn't talk about at all is about Waste Management 17. And one very exciting paper that was published there by somebody right here from Carlsbad, actually a member of CMERC. And that paper essentially and quite clearly makes a point that filtered ventilation is completely unnecessary to work safely at WIPP, and that you could just go to unfiltered ventilation and it wouldn't harm even a fly. It wouldn't even make a fly sneeze. Now, I have argued about that for the last few years, that I think we are in that situation. But now we have a scientific paper that was presented at Waste Management 17, and I think it has, well, to me, it has been known that that paper was in preparation for the last 4.5 months. So I would assume that DOE and other WIPP participants have been aware of that as well. So 4.5 months, and now I understand, maybe now you finally start officially thinking about that. So can you tell me about whether you're going to take that into account, because it presumably has the potential of saving hundreds of millions of dollars?
So, it was a very good paper, and we certainly were aware that it was being written, and the data in there we're certainly aware of. As far as the conclusion or where it would point you, we're looking at it in two ways. In the immediate short term, we're evaluating, are we operating the facility in the most efficient manner that we had? Obviously, in a filtered mode, you have less air under there, and so we're certainly starting to look at that. Down the line, the permanent ventilation system, it can be, although we talk a lot about the filtered building, it's being designed to run in an unfiltered mode in the future also, just for this very purpose. If the mine gets to the point where we feel comfortable with the potential releases associated with it, there's possibility we'll go back to a straight unfiltered mode for all operations in the future. We'll see. Those decisions are down the line, but we're certainly aware of it. And we are certainly taking it into account in our current thinking, both short-term and long-term.
Let me ask, do you mind if I ask?
Go ahead. Having to respond as well about some of the daiquiris.
Well, I would just, to add on to what.
You had to leave our last meeting prior to this coming up. We had a discussion about it. And there, I thought there were a couple of pretty salient points related to the DAC readings in panel 7.
They're all in the paper.
Yeah, it's a little bit different. But so the thing that, as part of the evaluation that Todd's talking about, the thing we have to look at is we need more data, because, there's certain places that some of the data in that paper references from. We have to look at also some of the data we get in the underground as well. And so part of the evaluation is we have to, again, look a broad spectrum of the data and not just certain data points that may, be representative of the surface. Those certainly play into that. But right now in the underground, when we're doing work in the underground, there's data that we get that says we have to have people in respirators. Otherwise, they would have an intake, a positive bioassay. And I don't think any of us want to put our workers in a position where they come back with positive bioassay samples. So there's a lot of things that have to be considered to make that type of decision, because if you say it's good enough for release to the environment, it also has to be good enough for the workers in the underground to be able to work in it without radiological PPE. And so that evaluation has to look at all of that. Does that answer?
I know. We're not going to have much of a bot back and forth on this.
Right. Right. Well, first of all, the usual answer is we need more data in order to avoid a decision. But the data were taken actually at the bottom of the exhaust shaft, which is before it gets through filtration. So, but in any case, that paper should be a topic of discussion for everybody inside and outside WIPP. And I'm just telling you, I will use that paper to talk to the representatives and tell them, if you're being asked to spend another $300 million on an additional shaft that is absolutely not necessary, is actually counterproductive in terms of overall facility safety and worker safety, then I will oppose that, and I will urge Senator Heinrich, Senator Udall, and Representative Pierce to vote against that kind of money, because it is my money, our money, and is being wasted.
All right, any other questions? Here we go, online.
Good evening, everybody. Just to let the people in our physical audience know, we've had about 21 people participating online throughout the evening. First question, does Panel 10 currently undergo periodic ground control inspections?
The area that would potentially be Panel 10 is the area between panels 8, 7, 8, 1, and 2. And the answer is yes, we do ground control in the area. Most of that area has been free released. It's been recovered. A few spots we're still working on, but we actively maintain that area. That's the travel path for waste going to Panel 7.
Thank you. Next question, what is the status of the above ground storage, and when could it be ready for use?
There was a permit change request, make sure that's the right word, permit modification request, submitted back in the fall. Comment period closed in February, so it's working its way through the regulatory process. We would anticipate a facility being ready somewhere around 2019.
Okay. You know, that's another point. Another point on the additional storage, it gives you a better ability to balance the containers in the facility. Right now, the storage is rather limited, and this gives a little more opportunity to be able to do that.
My next question is for Ms. Reynolds. Since which date have they been putting in 4 pallets a week?
Let's see. I think it's been 3 weeks now. The first 3 weeks, I believe it was one pallet per day, Tuesday and a Thursday. In the last 3 weeks, we were able to put in 2 pallets per day, Tuesdays and Thursdays. So it's been done multiple shifts now.
Okay. Next question, and this is to General. By the time panel 8 is filled, will panel 9 still be in a safe condition for waste disposal operations there?
No, it's the south end is panel 9. So panel 9 is the south end, and that's the end that we made a decision late last year to go ahead and abandon, and we're in the process of doing a closure on panel 9, which is that south end that was shown on that slide with the red area, the red box around it.
Would you mind, and I don't know if they meant this, but answering compared to 10 as well, that might have been what was intended there. By the time panel 8 is filled, will panel 10 still be in a safe condition for waste disposal?
So panel 10, which is that area Todd just mentioned, that's between 1 and 2 and 7 and 8, yes, that is being maintained, and that would still be available for waste disposal.
Okay. Next question. Since the quote-unquote new WIPP will be materially different than the WIPP that was evaluated in accordance with NEPA, when will the new environmental report be released, and when will NEPA's review begin?
The original or the evaluations that we have done through NEPA are still valid, and the analysis we've done, we still believe are valid. As new projects come online or as they're needed, we'll do additional NEPA. As expansion or other required activities require NEPA, we'll perform those activities.
Mr. I have three more questions. You want me to continue? Okay. Next question. There are outstanding MSHA violations, including ones from ground control from 2016. The most recent inspections resulted in 26 citations. When will ground control violations be fixed and no new ones?
So MSHA is one of our regulators, and they are required to do inspections, so they come periodically and do inspections. I would never say we would never get a citation, but, you know, part of their responsibility is when they do see something like a broken bolt or, you know, some other compliance issue, they write a citation. What we have to do is prioritize those citations because, as we showed on some of the charts up there, we still do have catch-up ground control activities ongoing, and we also prioritize those and schedule those in accordance with our ground control monitoring program as well as the citations. But there's not an ability to go and have endless resources and endless bolters and endless pieces of equipment to do everything simultaneously. So as we get the citations, we work with MSHA to look at, you know, what the citation is about, then we prioritize and schedule those citations so that we're continuously working those off. Now, what I would say is anytime a citation is written where there is a concern about the ground control in that area, then that area is prohibited, meaning that nobody else can go in that area until we do go back in there and do the ground control activities. So at least from entry, no one is going to be at risk from a safety standpoint because that area is physically barricaded off and prohibited from entry.
Thank you. Okay, my next question, has the design for the panel closure barrier strengths been changed due to the problems associated with the radiological accident in February of 2014?
So I believe I understand the question to be the closure of the panels.
Yeah.
So if it is, I'll take a stab at this one and see. Prior to the event, we were working with NMED at that point in time on submittal of a different design for permanent closure of the panels, and that permit revision or that permit mod had just gotten into the system and it was being evaluated. When the events occurred, that mod got put on hold. So there is a different approach that had been in the queue prior to the event, so it has nothing to do with the event. We just think there's another option, which is the use of run-of-mine salt instead of, like, concrete walls to do closure. And so that was in place and going through the process. So now we're moving back, putting that back in the queue for a permit mod and working with the regulators to continue that through the process and get that through approval.
Okay, Mr. Heaton, I have one more question. During one of the ceiling collapses about a year ago, did a panel closure barrier develop a hole through the interior? If that hole was formed, when do you expect that barrier to be repaired?
It's probably the one down at room four. Yeah. So I believe the one that's being referenced there is at the south end. So that was one of the panels, the earlier panels, and that was a ground fall where we had the temporary closure in place, which is a bulkhead. And so there was a ground fall in that area right in that entrance to that panel. And so as we indicated earlier, we've determined now that we are going to close the south end. And so there would not be any repairs to that area because we're going to put in the cribbing that I talked about and actually just block off that complete south end, which is where that location was.
Okay, thank you all very much for being here. Norbert Short. You're
going to
be
one. I don't give sermons. I'm not a preacher. Question, you mentioned that the core is actually stored in some climate-controlled storage. Is that on site?
The
core, yeah, the core that you ran.
You're
running it in a climate-controlled place here. Right. Well, it's an example, actually, of an ad hoc decision in the past of WIPP that came to bite us, because we used to have all the core that was taken at WIPP in a climate-controlled facility right on site. And then about 20 years ago, some lower-level CBFO manager got a hair up his bottom and had it all removed from there. And ever since, that core is in connexes or, you know, connexes without climate control. So I'm glad you put it in there. The other point is, and this is maybe for Mr. Walker, the transportation route from the south goes to Pecos and then up 285. I have been on 285, and also I have been on the road from Big Springs over. And I tell you, from a strict road safety perspective, I definitely prefer 176 from Big Spring out over. 285 is a bloody mess. So I understand that there are some regulations that require to use the interstate wherever possible, but I think that requirement might conflict with actual road safety. To what extent have you evaluated and compared those two?
Well, that's actually a decision that we work with the state transportation commission on. The routes that we have and the permanent route is the 285 route. That's the route that they want us to use. So, you know, we've negotiated with them, and that's the route they want us to use. Well, just for the WCS shipments. For the WCS shipments, we will use them. I can't say that I don't agree.
So anyway, that's out of their control. I think the state makes that decision. So at any rate, thank you all very much for being here. Great presentations. And thank you all for your questions, good questions. And we appreciate it once again, you being here and being interested. And this is a great project and much, much needed in the country. Thank you again.